Well, I remember watching the news, and the old high school football guy on MTV or whatever predicted us to win 3 games in the season.
I love that kind of stuff.
You guys just aren't going to be it.
We definitely weren't rebuilding.
We knew the expectations. They were low.
That's what I want to hear.
They had a lot to prove.
Pouring gas on the fire, I think it was great.
It did piss me off.
Obviously, you know, the news about Sam was devastating in a lot of ways. A lot of you were inspired by Sam. I mean, you looked up to him as a hero figure and a lot of the guys in his class. And that makes this particularly difficult. But one thing I could, you know, if I can shed one piece of light on this, it's difference between leaving a legacy and leaving a resume. His resume is pretty impressive, but he leaves an even greater legacy. And so we should strive to try to approach his legacy. You know, he spent his last day on earth working with kids, trying to make them better, you know, trying to touch other people's lives. And I'll tell you what, if you want to define what is an Islander, just put his picture on the wall. That's all you got to do. Honor, courage, commitment, loyalty, accountability, makes everybody around him better. You know, when I walked in, I could see him lifting at that rack right at the end with Will and then Thomas right by him. Right there, I could just see it plain as day. And 11 effort, no doubt about it. Every day and everything he did, but he did it with grace. He did it with a smile on his face and an infectious attitude. And that's what Coach Cludie and I were just talking about. The energy that you bring is a big part of your leadership. And he just had that infectious energy that made everybody around him better. So as we remember Sam, you know, we need to try to remember to live up. He's the guy that helped establish this culture. He's one of the many, but he's definitely one that exceeded the standard every day. And that's the best way we can honor Sam, just like we honor Nick. And what we do by exceeding the standard every day. And so we'll talk more as the week progresses about services and those types of things, and you know, I'll talk to you seniors. We'll get together and talk about how we want to honor Sam and how we want to continue to honor Nick and that type of thing. But I know everybody's thinking about him. Just keep family in your prayers, and best way to get through it is to work even harder as an honor and as a way to pay tribute to life well lived. No doubt about it.
Sam was a pretty important part of our family. He'd spent a lot of time at our house, and for both of my younger two sons was maybe the best friend they had. He's supposed to be the best man in Thomas's wedding here coming up in June. So that was when Coach T texted me that. I had kind of heard it, but I didn't want to, you know, do anything till I knew for sure. I knew I had to call my two boys, and that was maybe the hardest phone call I've had to make in my life up to this point in time. You know, it was hard for all of us, and you know, you're tempted to say why and what for, but then there is no answer to that. But I guess, you know, how I dealt with it with my boys and maybe some of the other, you know, people have known that is, you know, if Sam were here, he would, number one, have some kind of smart aleck remark for us all. But he would expect us to move forward, just as he had been taught, and the kind of person he was, to remember him, but to move forward and be difference makers, just like we've talked about here earlier. It's hard to process that because you have to look at your own mortality and you know the unpredictability of life. You know, sometimes people do everything right and they're great people and bad things happen. And so what do? You make the most of the moment you have and you love the people around you as best you can in the moment that you have, because there is no guarantee to the next moment. And so kind of fits with the way we live life in Grand Island, in Island of Power, in Island of Football. You love the people around you, you serve them as best you can, and you make the most of the moment and the time that you have. Well, he shared something with Thomas when Thomas was able to, you know, to get leave and come back home, and he says, you know, when time seems unlimited, and the window of life seems very, very large, you take a lot of things for granted. And you don't maybe enjoy, you don't maybe embrace things the way you should. But when time grows short and your window begins to shrink, then you truly know the value of a moment and the value of people around you. And you embrace them and you love them, although the more hard. And I can't, it's not the exact quote, but that was the gist of it. And I think that's really something, I guess, that we all need to remember every day, is we think we have unlimited time, and that's a myth. We don't. We need to love each other, and we need to serve each other, and we need to be excellent. We need to do all those things right, because we don't know when the last moment is.
Let's compete. Let's finish. Let's go.
CB on 3-1-2-3.
CB.
Coach Swanson's always taught us to continuously pursue excellence, so we thought that that'd be a good thing. Pursuing excellence every day in the classroom or on the field or just in everyday life.
That kind of molded around the fact that we were raised in the program and we were committed to that standard of excellence.
We knew we weren't the best, biggest guys ever, but we like to pursue excellence and be the best we could be.
It's something that describes our class really well. No matter how bad it gets, no matter how much you're underlooked, you keep striving for the best you can possibly be.
And through success and failure, you just consistently pursue excellence no matter what.
It's about every day. You know, it's not something where, you know, this is our end goal. This is just one bit goal at the end we're trying to get to. It's about doing it every day. And if you do it every day, then you should be where you want to be at the end.
That's kind of our theme every single year, but I think it fits very, very well right now, especially for this group of seniors, I think.
It's kind of right in line with our mission, and it was right in line with what I thought this team had to do and focus on to get the most out of themselves.
They came with the CPE attitude, and that's what allowed them to go from where they were, you know, coming in as freshmen to where they were as seniors. And Their leadership in the off season and conditioning was really, really good. So.
This week would be two. Did you set up and everything after squat?
Ever since I was a freshman, I wasn't very big. I used to be like really heavy, like 160 pounds, 5'2", and I was just a big ball. And then coming into Islander Power freshman year, I lost weight. I got to 140. And I wanted to change my position.
Islander Power has been, it's been amazing.
Borderline hell.
There's nothing really like it. It's just kind of, it's almost insane. The stuff they're yelling at us, making us duels, doing our workouts, swans, everyone, wrestling room, get a plate above your head. I mean, we could sit there for about 4 minutes at a time. He just screamed at us for no apparent reason. I mean, if you get in there, I mean, it's kind of also real to you, and it kind of freaks a lot of people out.
Challenging and very, very hard, especially on a fat guy like me.
It's not fun.
Tough, long, hard, and fun. I mean, it's rough getting up every morning and going in and not knowing what you're gonna have to do because every other day is something new with him.
It's unique. Swanson throws a lot of curveballs at you and makes you respond to a whole bunch of different, or anything he can throw at you, make you uncomfortable.
He's a loon. I would tell you what, first time I walked in freshman year, I was honestly intimidated by the guy. The dude's scary looking.
Most of the things Swanson puts us through, you want to quit. You're just thinking in your head, why am I doing this? I shouldn't even be doing this. Some days you'd go in like, I'm ready for whatever he's got, and some days it was dreading it. What else do we have to do today?
Actually, yeah, Swanson is crazy. I mean, all that stuff he made us do in the summer, that was just the worst.
And you just want to go home and just like go play some video games, open up a bag of chips.
You're ready to work. You have to work your butt off every single day, or else you might not be in there.
But no, you're in there grinding, trying to get bigger, trying to get better, all for the love of the game.
Finish. Go all the way to the wall.
Hey, keep going. You're not done.
Riley, keep going.
You ain't done.
Let's go.
Initially, I wanted leaders to emerge. And so when I began to design and program in, I knew that I wanted to create situations where leaders had to emerge, where people had to rise to the surface and take control of situations, because it's in that tension that leaders emerge. It's in that tension and overcoming that obstacle that confidence begins to emerge, and a lot of good things happen.
Let's go, Kyle. Come on, man. That boy.
Good job, Lonnie. That's a heck of an effort there, bud. Well done.
Coming out of the jungles of Quantico, you nailed that one. Good job, man.
You know, being comfortable and just doing enough to get by, that doesn't serve or benefit anybody. It's a selfish thing. And I know the world right now is a very selfish world, and you know, we don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. We want to, you know, we all want to be average because average is comfortable, and so we sink to that lowest common denominator. But my response and argument is well, we want to be uncommon. And if we're going to serve our world, we need to be uncommon. And uncommon people can't be comfortable. They have to be uncomfortable.
day.
Hop a Java down, you
know. Hopped up on that.
Look at him.
Okay, here we go.
That was the initial summer, and then when we had the schedule come out, and I thought, wow, this is maybe one of the toughest schedules we've had ever since I've been here for, well, 31 years in that building.
And so, you know, it was an eye-opener that first time you see it, and then it's like, okay, time to go to work.
A little uneasy at first. Coach T kept on saying it was one of the toughest schedules we've had in a long time.
It's Class A. It's always a tough schedule. There's maybe one game on there we planned on winning. You know, we'd be very disappointed if we didn't win, and the rest of them we knew we'd have to play well, and a couple that would be really, really tough.
You know, I felt like everybody else did, like, oh, crap. But more think about it, we wanted that challenge. We wanted to solidify ourselves as a group that competed every week. We didn't have an easy team on our schedule. We had the hardest district in Class A and probably the state. So I think going through the season, we didn't really think about it because every week we could prepare the same way. We prepare for a Bellevue East the same as an Omaha North. We just, that mindset's just all the way through the season.
I thought, well, this is what we need to do. We need to create challenges and make them very unpredictable.
I'm not going to give you a lot of details. You've got to figure this out. You're going to do it as a team. Here's what's going to happen.
So we've got our Hall of Fame lifting teams, right?
Right.
That's what he's talking about.
Right, which there are like 10 of them. There are five sleds. So how many teams are going to go first?
Five.
I'm not going to tell you which teams it are. Okay? One member of your team is going to grab this red card. You're going to go find a coach who can time it. You're going to say, Coach, could you time us, please? Okay? Your team will gather around that sled. You will all start with 10 push-ups. You're gonna say, somebody's gonna say, go. So coach knows when to start timing. All right? After you get 10 push-ups, one man, I don't know who it is, gonna run down to the end of that rope. Gonna sit down, spread eagle. Gonna pull that sled right in. Okay, once it gets there, While that's happening, all your teammates are gathered around you doing push-ups continuously. Once it's here, I'm gonna get up, I'm out of the loop. One of you is gonna have to grab the end of that rope, run down, sit down, spread eagle, start pulling. The rest of you are gonna do what? Gather around and do push-ups. That's gonna happen continuously until that sled gets down to the end line on the other side. Does everybody understand what's going to happen here? So time begins when somebody says,
go.
Everybody's doing push-ups. If you're not pulling, you're doing push-ups around your teammate. Right? I don't care if they're little girl push-ups. Slobber snotting the whole time. Nobody's just standing around. Nobody's just watching. Nobody's just on their knees. We're working the whole time. All right? I'm an old man, I can pull those things, you guys can do it. Pulling, until it comes in to home plate.
So obviously, right? The faster you can pull,
yep.
The more respite you give your teammates, at least for a couple seconds, and yourself.
Spread eagle, gotta pull all the way in. When you get it all the way in touching you, okay, get up, get out. Somebody's gotta step in, start pulling, okay?
You gotta get all the way through the end line. So depending on what teams may be a little off, maybe some guys have to go twice, right? It's part of figuring out the mission.
It's got to get done.
It's part of getting it done.
It's kind of like a drive to win the game. Little 5-8 yard chunks at a time, right? Going to grind it out. Cards are here. There are five pins right here. Figure it out. Let's go.
I need to create storms. Storms that come up, unpredictable storms that you can see on the horizon.
I'll be with you here telling you guys what to do. Now get back on your tire.
Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
All right, thank you.
Well, I was really nervous when the Marines showed up. I knew it'd be a really tough challenge.
I was really nervous going into that, not knowing what to expect, and went into it. It was hard. I think the hardest part was probably making sure that you didn't let someone fall behind and make sure that they stayed with you, because you just want to go as fast as you can and get it done, but you got to keep that person up with you. I think the worst thing about that was honestly getting my fat butt down and army crawling. It was terrible. Yeah, that was terrible.
It didn't matter what anybody threw at him. It didn't matter if something was expected or unexpected, that if you just keep your head and you respond with your brothers and you move as one and you lean on each other, you could weather the storm and come out a better person on the other side of it.
Get it figured out. Let's go. It's not a picnic here, fellas. Let's go.
Gonna learn today.
Come on, right away. Want it to hurt, because that's how you get better.
Come on, all you're doing is showing your team you're weak. Let's go.
Good job, man.
Good job.
All right, somebody take charge. Get around. Yeah. Sprint to the end of the line. Don't give a crap! Nobody cares how tired you are!
You always respond. There are going to be storms in life. There are going to be bad things that happen. There are going to be things that make you uncomfortable. And you shouldn't be alarmed by it, because it just is. You have the tools to make it through, to correct your course, to come out okay, and just continue to serve.
I was talking to John and Kyle about it, and they hyped it up a lot too, but some of the stuff Swanson's made us do is four times worse than that.
I'll take that as a compliment, but... By the way, that was supposed to be secret too. That was a planned deal. I knew long in advance. But we have, you know, two young men who've decided they're going to serve our country and our system, and be Marines. And somehow the word got out. So I needed to probably brief those Marines too and say, hey, this is ears and eyes only. But in any case, yeah, I take that as a compliment. So.
So every day next week, we're 6 a.m. on the field. That's not 6 a.m. leave your house. That's not 6 a.m. just screech up right there. That's we're already on the field. So I would plan on getting here at 5:45.
Ours is a different animal, and the way to attack it is almost as if we are part of a military academy. Embracing those core values and kind of taking that underdog approach, because we don't have as big athletic pool. as a lot of the folks we play, or maybe the talent pool. So we have to do the little things right, and we have to out-prepare and out-work folks. And it's worked well for us, and I think overall, that serves the kids the best later in life, too.
And you think about the town we're in, too. It's a blue-collar town. A lot of them have blue-collar mom and dad. So it's, you know, it fits right in. I'm from a blue-collar family. You know, there's something to be proud of there.
I say we're a blue-collar program. We all accept it. We're all happy to be part of it. It makes us better. I'm going to learn lessons from this program that I'll carry on the rest of my life. Push through things, a great work ethic. It needs to happen for us to be able to compete in our level, and I think it's just great.
You don't need talent to be successful. I mean, where we identify as blue collar because working hard gets the job done. You don't always need talent. So GI is the place for that.
There's not one guy on our staff that I would consider a guy from privilege or a guy that doesn't want to roll up his sleeves and get his hands dirty. So I'm blessed with all the blue-collar staff. That's most of our backgrounds growing up.
We were all really embraced that. We just all really took on that blue-collar attitude that pretty much all Islanders have, and we just really went with that.
Coach D always says that if we don't have that mentality, then we can't keep up with the metro schools and all that. So we got to come every day thinking we're the underdogs.
Coming with that blue-collar, hard-nosed, and tough mentality, that gets the job done more than talent.
We're a blue-collar school, put on the hard hat, we go to work. It doesn't matter, you know, what hat we're going to respond in a way that puts us in a position to be successful. We're not going to react, we're going to respond. It doesn't matter what the storm is. We're going to do a quick course correction, steer right into it, and we'll come out the other side in better shape.
Find a way or grind away.
We're just common everyday people. We get up and go to work every day, and we're tough because we do it. We're the blue collar school. We get up every day, get our lunch pails and our hard hats, and we go to work and we start breaking rock. And GI Tough is just that kind of person that's okay with that, that embraces it. That's who I am, that's what I do, and I'm gonna get up every day, and I'm just gonna break rock with my sledgehammer.
Winning's fun, but what happens between winning one game and another is a whole lot of discomfort. To me, that's GI Tough. Just learn to embrace that. Because until you do, life's rough.
Something. I don't know if you're hearing me.
Yes, sir.
There you go. One inch at a time. One inch at a time.
We don't waste a second. Every second that we have is a gift. You don't waste a gift. You honor the gift giver by how you use that moment. Come in here every day ready to work, ready to pour yourself out for the people around you, ready and willing to be uncomfortable because it makes everybody around you better, and to make a positive difference in the lives of the people that surround you. This is as good a collection of men that we could put around our kids. I mean, I thank them so much for their commitment. Their loyalty is unmatched, their drive, their work ethic. The greatest compliment I can pay our staff is, and a number of them did coach my son, and that's part of why he is a great young man today. Not because of me, you know, because of his mother, and because of his other coaches that he's been surrounded with. But I'd want them coaching my son every day and twice on Sunday. And there's no greater compliment I can give him than that.
I don't think you're gonna go anywhere and have coaches not care about you, but this coaching staff cares about our guys. You don't put in the time we put in and do the stuff we do if you don't care about them. And to me, that's the best part about football. It's the guys. People are shocked when I tell them that we work 7 days a week. That blows people's minds that you work 7 days a week. And when you're working doing something you love doing, it's a lot easier to do, I'll say that. As far as spending time away from the family, you know, to a certain extent, you know, I'm with my other family. And my kids know it. Though, you know, I think of my defensive end specifically, but the players as a whole, when I have my kids around, they're great to them. They're, you know, my girls are little sisters to them, and my boy's a little brother to them, and it is family. So, I mean, I'm spending a little bit more time away from my family, but I'm with my other family. And I, at the same time, I think it's setting a good example for my kids, you know, that if you pour your heart into something, you know, no matter how it turns out, it was worth it.
You won't find a more committed group as far as the staff. You won't find a better strength conditioning coach in America. You won't find a better trainer and training staff, athletic staff, faculty. I'm very proud to be a part of this school.
it's just a blast, though. You know, it's a blast. We've got an unbelievable staff. We have too much fun, and no, we don't. We have just the right amount of fun, but and the kids have a lot of fun too. And I think they see it's okay to, you know, obviously working hard is, you know, fundamental to life, but it's okay to have fun and work hard too.
Oh man, what's up? We had one of these. You get in trouble with those, man.
I hope you're not me, because you look like
shut up my face, I'll kill you. I can't stay serious.
Hey, new nickname in the group, Grim Death. Hey, just so, hey, Jeremy.
Keep him.
He's
Okay, we're
gonna
have, I made two guys in the group. And then a personal special female,
they
throw
that,
right,
you throw that. As far as big guys,
I'm
16 of these.
Coach T, I'm
gonna have to pee soon. Coach T! I have to pee! What do you want me to do? Pee my pants? No! No! Jeff! What? Get my no. Get over here. Okay.
McQueen's trying out for the school play. Abe Lincoln. He's got to be, because if he's not, why else would you have that unsightly beard? So he's definitely going Abe Lincoln on it. And Abe Lincoln was a good man. He was a good man. Right, Coach? Yeah.
My favorite president.
He said Kirby's leaving. Bye, Kirby.
Look, what? Okay.
Kind of showing you, obviously.
Like by a bowel.
Rabbits?
Purple?
These guys will get you plenty of footage. I promise you this. Joey's gonna. He's decided he wasn't on the highlight video enough last year.
He did feel slighted.
No. No, he didn't. For one. But for two, this is soon to be the Joe Weld show.
Hey, hood guy.
Got a schedule?
Yeah, 6A freaking in. Every day.
I can't be here today. I got appointments.
I just zoom out score, everyone. Fucking money man's out, baby. He needs defense. Defense? Coach T? Defense? Just let the O solve the problems, man. Should I tell him that? D? What?
Dude. You have fun with that, huh?
Smack!
You take it home? Play with it a little bit?
How you doing?
Losing my Jimmy.
Yo. Boom.
I had a small fit of rage and tore them off my head. Spiked him on the ground and kicked him. And then after the two practice sessions, I've been too tired to take him in because I get in my chair and he can't get me out of my chair without a large spatula.
Stick to dismount, Joey.
You could have been a steel worker.
Oh, we
Do your triple sow cow.
Oh, you kidding me?
Reel that compliment back in. No more compliments for you today.
How you doing, buddy? What do you think? How many years does this make for you? How many years does this make for you? It's got to be 4 or 5, doesn't it?
I think you're on round 5.
Huh? Yeah.
I think you're on year 5.
Put your years together and my years together, and we're seasoned veterans, aren't we? Huh?
I guess so.
Yeah.
These kids are incredibly smart. These kids know the Islander history. They've watched Islander football for years. They knew that we were limited in some spots, but just because you're limited physically doesn't mean you have to be limited competitively.
After the last game last year, I think we were looked upon as the class that wasn't really much, and that we were just the feeder class, like that would, we would need the juniors to step up big, and we would be the class that didn't have much success.
We kind of joke about it now after the season's done of how many wins we actually have. Because like coming in, they were saying that we weren't going to do anything productive at all, like having a losing season and being smaller than the rest of the classes, not being able to do anything against any of our opponents.
We were a little rough coming out of the gate. I mean, that's how I think every football team would be. But I could tell that we needed a little work running the ball and receivers and QBs throwing it around and all that. And just knowing our stunts and blitzes on defense, and just knowing the proper technique for football.
We kind of tried to ignore it because we're our own team and we're not going to let others define us. We wanted to make a name for ourselves.
I think it gave most of us like an edge, push ourselves harder and prove them wrong.
This group of seniors, you know, not a lot of speed, you know, just flat out. That was one of the things that, as sophomores anyway, you know, the teams that we had a hard time against were the fast teams. And so, you know, finding a way to make use of the guys we had with speed on both sides of the ball was a key factor. And then, you know, having guys step up in certain spots, like we talked about when you're replacing so many positions, is really an important thing, so.
I was feeling good, definitely about our leadership. I felt good about our work ethic, which are all the things I'm most concerned about. Definitely concerned about inexperience.
A lot of seniors, a lot of good leaders, but not guys who've been in the fire before.
Definitely concerned about filling spots, definitely concerned about how quickly we'd have a quarterback emerge.
Coach said that he wants a quarterback that the team wants. He wants to play the quarterback that the team respects, responds to, reacts well with, and I wanted to prove to them that I would be that quarterback. It's not about you, it's about the whole team, and I just wanted to make the team better coming up. I thought it was really cool that I got the opportunity to start as a senior, though.
You know, we knew these kids were going to be an incredibly hard-working group. Attitude, coachability were going to be off the charts. We knew we were going to get their very, very best every day. So that takes a lot of the edge and a lot of the worry off. It was just more the how good a team can we put on the field and can we get them ready in time.
You don't kick slide as one, you put your teammates in grave danger.
On red, on red!
Hey, I'm mainly an O guy and a receiver. Perhaps I could help on scout. I'm a sophomore. Perhaps I could help on scout.
Reset. Here we go. Reset. Work your feet. Work your feet. Hands inside. Elbows in tight. Get through, let's go.
Good.
Nice.
Good read, nice throw.
Is there anybody on top of you? There was post safety, right? So as soon as I get by collision, turn and look. Good. Vertical right now. Ah, shoot, get vertical.
Vertical right now.
Hey. Start back on top of one, coach.
Tyler Crash, you got signals. Let's go.
Whoa. Stop. Jaren, what just happened?
Garrett, you were capped, weren't you? Yeah, I mean, he was right on your nose, wasn't he?
Yeah. All right.
Set go. Set go.
Down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. Get your woke up. Let's go.
I'm awake.
Adjust to the ball, meathead.
What am I doing? What am I doing? Why would I? What am I doing?
Sophie, you're back there too. Offensive line and backs. Sure over there.
Knock it out of here, BC.
Good ball, guys.
Hey, kiddo. Hey, BC. Good thump, kid. Atta boy. Most of these guys wouldn't last 5 minutes in our neighborhood.
This is what I do with Ryan. This is how I coach him. What do I do?
Nothing. Yeah.
That's why he's so good.
You know what? You know why? That's why I say good job, B.
Thank you.
Because we're bros. Aren't we? We're Carnellis. Right? Don't ever forget it.
I thought our defense would be really good. Our offense, I was a little worried about just because Tyler and the rest of most of us were new.
It got easier week by week, you know, getting more comfortable running the plays and working with everybody as a team, and just knowing that they had my back as long as I had theirs.
I mean, I love all of our guys this year, but last year, I mean, we just had athletes and just big playmakers, and we lost a lot of those this year, and we didn't have any returning starters, but like I said earlier, we just kind of embraced that blue-collar work ethic.
You know, we had a lot of guys that did step up.
Personally, I was feeling good about the team. I felt we'd pull through together.
I guess you could say I was pretty concerned at the beginning, and then once we all got together, I just felt like we'd be fine.
We didn't seem to be early grasping all the defensive concepts that I wanted to see him grasp, although we quickly got on top of that. But I think a lot of that was the youth and inexperience, guys that just hadn't played. You get spoiled when you have maybe some guys that have started for a couple of years, and so they already know.
Everyone was really nervous. I was nervous because I didn't know how good we were going to stack up against everyone else. But we just knew that if we all pulled together and fought as a team, then we would do all right.
You're always, as a coach, you're always nervous. I mean, you feel like, you know, if you graduated five guys, they're the five most important guys you ever coached. And so you always worry about filling those holes. We go stretches of years and years between Division I guys, and we go against guys every week that'll have, you know, a couple, three of them. That's our edge, is we're gonna outwork them.
There's always a lot of, you know, I can't really shut my mind off, and so a lot of times there's a little bit of worry and trepidation. Doesn't matter what season it's going into.
Especially as a senior, there's a whole bunch of pressure.
The fact that the schedule was what it was has just made it even more stressful.
Basically, you don't judge anyone on their size or what their capabilities are. It's all about, it's in your heart, pretty much. Like, us as a team, we felt unstoppable no matter what anyone else thought.
That's all I could think about the whole week. Everyone's asking me, you seem different this week. So I'm just nervous. Just let me be. Especially when it came Friday, I was just like, just need to be myself. It was a really nervous week for me.
I mean, senior season is just really, that's when it starts to like wear on you. Like, wow, like it's go time, and you're starting to get mentally prepared. You know all the specs for that game. You're studying your scouting report. Like, hell, I even knew it was gonna be 75 degrees at kickoff. I had that memorized all week long, and I we were just all just ready. We really wanted to get after him.
I was really nervous for the Kearney game, the first one. All of my anxiety had been building up since I got through the last season. I was ready to play him.
Definitely nervous about, did I do my best in preparing them for all that they're going to see that first game? Because there's so many situations in football, and there's so many variables that you'd have to practice 6-8 hours a day to prepare them for absolutely everything.
I was ready. I was pretty well prepared, I think. And I think people really underestimated me as far as being even halfway decent.
right before the game, I just got myself so worked up. I actually started to cry a little bit, and Tyler came over and talked to me about it.
We were all nervous. The whole week, it was... We were all just, you know, clenching our stomachs. We didn't know what we were capable of ourselves of doing, and we were so worried about being like last year's and the years before.
Well, we knew Kearney would be good, first of all. You know, they've got a good group of seniors over there this year, and so we knew it would be a tough challenge, but at the same time, we felt like we prepared as well as we could.
Before any home opener, I'm very anxious. And then you throw in a little rivalry game, and then you're even a little bit more on edge.
So I challenge you on three things, didn't we? One, be who we are. We're junkyard dogs, okay? We're junkyard dogs. We are GI Tough. That's who we are. Okay, carry your lunch pail out there right here in your heart. Okay, and just outwork and out hit. Okay, clock in, pound the rock. That's what we do is break rock. Okay, two, take the action to them. And the energy, we got to control what we can. And those two things we can control. And have a huge R factor. Have a huge R factor. Yeah, let's respond. Big time.
The Islanders did win the opening toss tonight, elected to defer, so Kearney will get the ball first and travel south here at Grand Ellis Memorial Stadium.
Came out pretty hot. We shut him down right away, and I had a lot of confidence right there.
Third down in the yard, Urbonic takes it towards the perimeter on the right side, and the Islanders came firing through and erasing him off the play was Colton Kayser.
We kind of came out and almost a little bit laid an egg on offense, and that kind of sucked.
Going out there the first play, it seemed like everything was going 200 miles an hour.
First down and 10. They're going to try their ground game, and nothing doing as the Bearcats came through on a big blitz, and Dunning's going to be taken down back at the four-yard line. Second down, option read, dropping him back in the end zone, I believe, or they're going to mark him at the one. They say that forward progress is going to get to the one-yard line, but Tyler Kress was quickly hit as he tried to get an option read going out of the backfield, and the Islanders have gone straight backwards on their first two plays.
Slowly. It just slowed down a lot, and you could make your plays, make your reads.
Islanders will go out of the gun, read option. Kress comes up firing, lays it out on the right side. He's got a man in the area. Are you kidding me? He caught that for a first down for the Islanders at the 33-yard line. Penalty flag in the offensive backfield. Actually, it's going to be a face mask against the Islanders. So with the penalty being in the end zone, Kearney's going to get a safety. And take an early 2-0 lead here at Memorial Stadium. Not exactly the kind of start you want.
After about the first drive, your adrenaline's going down and you're just playing the game football then.
2-0 deficit for the Islanders with 6:46 left to play in the first. Tyler Kress getting his first start for the Islanders. Swing pass left side, pass complete on the money, running room, and the Islanders are going to have a first down. Gain of 14 on the play. They give it off inside to Dunning, and all of a sudden there's a huge race up the middle, and Dunning blasts his way straight ahead. Kress sends everybody out in the pattern, steps up in the pocket, has some room, feeling pressure from behind, rolling right, throws it back across the middle. That pass is complete. First down, Islanders. Will Moorhees got himself open across the middle of the field, and the Islanders keep the drive alive. Kress works out of the gun, feels some pressure, throws it in the end zone. And Kenny caught it. Touchdown, Islanders. What an answer by the Islanders. They go 95 yards in 10 plays. The Islanders have taken the lead. 4:02 left to play here in the first quarter. It's Grand Island 7, Kearney 2. This is Islanders football from KRGI Sports.
I'd say during the first drive, when Tyler Kress and the offensive line and everyone drove down the field, I'd say that's when everyone knew that we could play football.
Defense, we were holding on, and then Reed got about killed, and that was when we were all kind of like, well, these guys can play too, so.
You know, we saw early on that they exposed us in a couple areas from what we had done in the past season.
And so they were hurting us with a pitch play that they hadn't ran before to the weak side, and so we were trying to come up with something to adjust to that. You know, kudos to them for having a good plan.
Two turnovers tonight by the Islanders. They lost a fumble and now have given up an interception with less than a minute to go. And that's going to do it. Kearney did what they needed to do. They came in, got an early score by virtue of a safety, came up with a couple of stops on the Islanders when they tried to go for it on fourth down, and then a late score helped to put it away. And Kearney turns back the Islanders tonight by a final score of 26-14.
We didn't feel like we really played very well in the first half overall. Maybe had left some chances out there. And I felt like after the game, you know, had we taken advantage of a few things in the first half, it could have been totally different. Because we did play with them other than the few areas that they hurt us. So
no one really got down on anyone because obviously we lost, but everyone stayed together as a whole.
After the game, we knew where we were. We knew what we needed to improve, and it gave us something to work from. You know, we had a base then.
Like the first game, I couldn't really play because my sister was getting married, so that really kind of irritated me and frustrated me. So, that was my big concern. I really wanted to play.
We saw some problems that needed fixed, but you know, we were a little shorthanded not having David there, and we had guys playing positions they'd never played before. You know, they'd only been practicing for a week in some spots, so,
when I first got back with them Monday morning, I was like, their confidence is again shaken. My vibe, my feel for their vibe was they're going to move forward and work hard, but they're all just kind of, they're waiting to see what happens next. They're not real sure what's going to happen next. They're not real sure if this season's going to turn out like they want to, and they're all walking on eggshells. And it's not one that they didn't work hard, but there was just that vibe about them. We did our morning workout, and I pulled them all aside, and then I just, I'd kind of come to the point where it's like, okay, this is enough. And I just pulled them all together, and I said, I got one question for you. Why not? And I let them just sit. No, I'm asking, why not? Why not you? And I challenged him, and I said, you know what, I've put you through more than anything, any team I've ever put through. So why not you? Why don't you deserve to have every bit of success that the other teams have? And I think that was, it was kind of a big moment because I looked them all in the eye and it was like, well, why not you? I think some of them kind of after that loss, they took that as, well, maybe not, but why not?
And Swanson sat us down and we had a talk about how this is our class, this is our season. Don't live in the shadows of last year's class and the previous classes before us, because we've kind of been living in those shadows because we weren't as talented as those teams, but we needed to take a hold of our team and make it our own. And that was the bounce back theme, respond factor. So I think we did that week.
That's exactly it. We wanted to respond. We didn't want to be that team that started out 0-2. We wanted to keep going, and we didn't want to be 0-2.
Just attack everything and work hard in practice, because practice is how we're going to resemble in a game.
It all started in practice, that's for sure. Everyone was high tempo, you know, kept it going.
You know, North Platte, as freshmen, that same group as freshmen, beat our seniors, you know, pretty handily.
Hey, we just got to be resilient, bounce back, we'll get this. Kids had a great week of practice, as I remember. And obviously, coaching staff-wise, we were very concerned. They had a lot of weapons returning. The North Platte folks are justifiably so very excited about their squad, best squad, you know, it was touted since Danny Woodhead played for the Bulldogs. So no doubt, very well coached team by Coach Madison, and a lot of weapons. So we were real concerned, you know, go on a road game and in a rivals territory, and we're as of yet unproven.
Goes without saying, you can't wait until the third round to start throwing haymakers, right? Okay, you can't start out probing and just circling. Got to tap, okay? Our energy level's got to be at its height at 7, at kickoff, and then it's got to be sustained. Okay, you've been dropped into a very volatile situation. Now we got to fight our way out of it, don't we? Okay, good chance that we'll get a little bit wet. Bring it on. Okay, we're ready for it. Makes us focus and concentrate that much more. Okay, we respond to any conditions, anything that confronts us, right? But we've got to dig it out of there, okay? He's a pretty good kicker. He'll likely go zone. Okay, we can't assume that, but he's got that kind of leg. So we're starting at the 20. We got to grind out 3 or 4 first downs, O-line. Okay, we can't wait to feel them out. And they're going to be teed up. So we got to get after their right away, and let's move the ball. And let's flip the field position wise. And then we can work on scoring. But we got to string together a couple first downs first, right?
North Platte exploded out of the gates with a dominating 42-7 win at Fremont. So they're coming into their first home game riding high.
During that North Platte game, that's when I really just like let it loose and went to work, because I was really, really frustrated that I couldn't play my first game against Kearney.
North Platte is coming in with a load of confidence and trying to see if they can put on a good show in front of a great home crowd.
That's a game where we're just playing football.
Islanders looking at 2nd down and 9 from their own 32, opening drive of the ball game. Kress wants to throw, sets up a screen, pass is complete, room to run, that's Garcia. Back in the lineup for the Islanders, and will have a first down as he stretches ahead to the 42-yard line. Bulldogs show blitz, Kress sees a seam, goes right at the blitzer, still moving the pile, and gets it down to the 31-yard line.
Usually don't see the quarterback on quarterback draw dragging defenders with him, but Kress that time dragging 3 guys with him as he was picking up additional yardage. The chains move again.
This will be a 30-yard field goal attempt. Covarrubias' kick is up, catches in the wind, but goes right through the middle, and the Islanders take an early lead. 2nd down and 8. North Platte in their first possession. The Islanders leading it 3-0. Quick swing pass left side and a textbook tackle in the open field. Tyler Sextro showed how you're supposed to do it, and they can use that one on film because he lined him up beautifully. Shoulder pads right at the thighs and made sure he went nowhere.
We came out really fast and good at that game.
They came out and played just lights out.
And then we just kept the hammer down and just got after them, really.
This is Garcia stepping away from defenders, lowers his shoulder, gets the first down. He did not play last week and said, you know what, we need a little contact, and probably blasts his way for 10 yards. Running room, that's Garcia. He's going to have a first down as he gets it out to the 49-yard line. Lob to the end zone, then Kenny got behind the defense and makes the catch. Touchdown, Islanders. Check this out, Tyler Kress straight ahead. A design quarterback draw and gets 15 yards. Islanders quickly back in the no huddle. Look, this is Garcia again. Steps inside one tackler, spins inside the 15. Fake it to Garcia, this time it's Kress spinning inside. The North Platte defenders stop moving. Kress keeps the pile moving and takes it into the end zone for a touchdown. Tyler Kress bulldozing his way in for a score. Bulldogs are out of timeouts. They got to do everything on the field and with the sideline routes. Throw over the middle, incomplete. And Cole Evans put a little pow on Bryson Krull as he tried that crossing route. That's back against the ground. He's going to be sacked. That was Colton Keiser that came on the blitz and made sure that he did not get away. Jackson Pawene blowing up the middle and blowing up the play. And trying to scramble. It's going to be sacked. Layaway. Was able to get the sack for the Islanders. Feeling some pressure. Islanders come and they're going to drop him again. Dropping straight back to throw. Pumps short. Looks long. Lays it out in the end zone. The Islanders have a man there and that's an interception. Peyton Kenny gets the pick. And the Islanders will get it out at the 20-yard line. Here comes pressure, trying to throw the little throwback screen. Islanders had that played perfectly, and what a terrific open field tackle over here. Tyler Sextro comes up and does it again. Kress steps up, wants to throw on first down. Got a man behind the defense, that's Kenny. Caught it, 20, 10, 5, touchdown, Grand Island.
Beats the corner and the free safety of North Platte. The ball extremely well thrown, and Kenny off to the races for the touchdown.
Pressure again, got the pass away, that'll be incomplete. The Islanders getting him in the backfield and are able to make the stop. Give it off inside, Garcia's got running room. They are not going to catch him. 20, 10, 5, touchdown, Grand Island. 65 yards.
The DBs of North Platte could not catch him. 65-yard touchdown right up the middle.
Welcome back, David Garcia. 65 yards for the touchdown.
I think we gained a lot of momentum feeling that first win of the season, and that got us going.
You know, the Omaha Northwest game, there was a lot of unknowns. We haven't played them, you know, since I've been around here.
Well, I knew Steve Warren and his staff with a wealth of football playing experience. A great football background. We're building some excitement. That's a program that's on the rise. They're getting kids out. They're getting transfer kids. They had athletes on film that we were very impressed with. So we were quite concerned going in. We knew we'd have to play a very good game.
We knew they were big. Most of my teams are big. We knew they had really good athletes on their team. So we knew that our brotherhood that's what's kept us together is our brotherhood. We knew that we could fight anybody with that.
It felt good to have David.
It could have been a totally different game if the defense would have stepped up. I remember the 7-6 at halftime, the offense was struggling, and they could have been up 21-7 at halftime if the defense would have stepped up for us before we got our groove going. So I thought it was huge. I thought they played great that game.
That's huge for confidence. You get fourth down stops, goal line stops. That boosts a D's confidence huge.
We really did kind of find our identity then, goal line stands. You know, that quarterback for Omaha Northwest was one of the better dual threat quarterbacks we faced all year, and he gave us some fits.
Our defense was extraordinary. We played low, we played physical, we did everything Coach T's taught us.
I knew our kids were starting to catch fire. They were starting to believe a little bit. And we responded to some early adversity. You know, back against the wall, gave them a score there, and were able to fight back and really take control of the game.
But I think after that you know, North Platte, Northwest game, those two games, we kind of found our spot as far as, you know, being confident, but also knowing we got to have an edge.
That was a big game to the seniors and myself. It was an important game. Didn't know if it'd ever take place, but they put a beat down on us a little bit as sophomores. When these two classes were both sophomores, it was a home game. And I remember being on the sideline, of course, and our sophomore staff working their tails off, and they had an excellent squad. And beat us up pretty good, and we met, you know, after the game, and, you know, hey, keep your chin up, we got to respond, we got to get back to practice tomorrow. And after practice the next day, I said, hey, sophomores, come on over here. And I was about on the 25-yard line or so on the east side, and we just talked about, hey, what do you feel like? You know, what kind of resolve does that, you know, start producing in your gut after you take a beating like that, and we basically made a vow between them and myself that this team was not going to be outworked. We're going to do everything in our power to be the most prepared, the tightest brotherhood, and the hardest working team that we could. And if indeed we did get a chance down the road, I predicted we would. But heck, there's no way I could know that. I think I was thinking maybe playoff time. We'd maybe see Lincoln East because we knew they had an excellent squad. That maybe down the road, perhaps when you're seniors, you'll get a chance to play them again. And we'll close the gap in these 2 years. And when we meet them, we'll change the outcome.
It was two teams meeting again to see who improved the most. And we showed that we worked harder. We improved more. We wanted it more.
Bring an edge.
And we're bringing an edge every play. We're bringing the GI edge every play. Because we got it. That's our edge right here. Okay? We might not have any other edges, but we got it right here. That's our edge. GI tough, play hard.
Yeah. Welcome back to Grand Isle Memorial Stadium. What is a beautiful night for football. Islanders to kick it away. Brian Covarrubias tries that one deep. That's going to get into the end zone and sails over the head of the return man. Walters wants to throw. Left-handed thrower. Pumps once, trying to run out of the pocket, and he's going to go down. Pursuit came from the backside. There to seal it off was Griffin Wins. On the read option and got caught from behind. Griffin Wins came crashing in from behind and was able to make the play for Grand Island. Walters, the left-handed thrower, rolling left, feeling pressure. He's going to be sacked and taken out of bounds at the 7-yard line. Laid away. Came over and got the sack for the Islanders. Back to the empty backfield. Now Garcia comes on the fly sweep. They set up a double reverse, and they've got some blocking. This is Nord Hughes. He's got running room, caught from behind, but gets a first down for the Islanders as he stretches ahead to the 45-yard line. Kress pumps. Has a man deep behind, double coverage, laid out there for Kinney, right in the red basket. Touchdown, Islanders! 1:08 left to play in the first quarter. It's Grand Island 7, Lincoln East nothing. This is Islanders football on the KRGI Sports Network.
Oh boy. you never expect that. I mean, four interceptions. Read about that stuff, you don't see it.
Incredible. That best individual performance I've ever seen, bar none, 30 years. It was remarkable.
You know, you don't really realize it. You're so involved with the game. I mean, you realize when he makes a play, but it was like, okay, good turnover. And then it's like, yes, another turnover. And then all of a sudden you look down at the box score at the end and you're like, wow, he had four interceptions. That's not bad.
A little bit was being in the right place at the right time, but we just worked so much on covering the post, covering the fade, and I guess, like Coach G always says, that in pressure moments that you're gonna sink to the level of your training, and I guess that's just kind of the coach's training really kicked in that game.
Walters keeps two in the backfield. Fakes the toss play. Islanders come with pressure. Puente came up. Walters trying to lay it out long. The Islanders get the pick back at the 35-yard line. That's Kitty on the reception. Peyton Kitty with the pick. Walters drops straight back. Now looking towards the left side. Looks back over the middle. Jump ball. Kitty has another interception at the 5-yard line. Blockers out in front. Gets to the 30. The 35 escorted out of bounds. Now first and 15. Walters wants to throw. Looking left, feeling some pressure. Eludes though. Fires for the corner of the end zone. The Islanders get a pick again. Peyton Kitty. The big three comes up with his third pick of the night. Walters drops straight back. Looks over the middle. Passes intercepted again. That's Kitty, his fourth interception of the game, and he's got room to run. He's going to just allow himself to be escorted out of bounds. The East receiver turned the wrong way. Peyton Kitty waiting for his fourth interception, and the Islanders have a chance to run out the clock.
Oh, that was crazy. I mean, I think the last one was mine, but I the receiver's going out for a route. I was dropping back, didn't see the receiver. He ran into me. He fell down with me. Peyton picks it off, and I was like, you know what? You're welcome, Peyton.
Really? Really? I don't know about that.
Reed got sawed in half when he missed that ball, I think.
Three? I'm pretty sure he had four, didn't he? Was Reed trying to steal his glory?
Oh, no, he had four.
I don't know what to say about that.
I'll give it to Reed. Reed can have it. Peyton had three. That's good. Reed can take it.
Oh, that's right. He kept saying, "Oh, you're welcome, Peyton."
Well,
if he said it was his, then why didn't he get it?
He was busy falling down, or what?
Yeah. And I'll let those two fight it out. As long as the Islander defense came up with the football, I'm good with whoever takes credit.
Well, you know, Reed can shape it. As you get older, don't worry. The memories will be even more warped in your favor, so.
Yeah, Reed claims, which he did, he took a pretty good hit on it because the wide receivers were on a crack corner, and when he was running his crack, he kind of hit Reed, and the wide receiver never looked for the ball, so the quarterback threw it. Reed was on the ground. I happened to be in the place and caught the ball. So Reed probably should get credit for that last pick.
Are you going to give him credit for it?
I'll give Reed credit for that last pick.
Our guys just played their guts out.
I think that definitely gave our team the feeling that we can do anything. Because there wasn't ever really self-doubt in our team, but there was always that we don't want to be bad, you know?
High-arching throw, that's Kitty! At the 10, the 5! Touchdown, Grand Island! Oh, my goodness!
You never really know how other teams are compared to you until you play those few games because you've only ever played against yourself.
Way to carry us, baby! Way to carry us!
And then to have Peyton step up and make the plays that he made at the times that he made them. And the picks were all incredible. It's probably his fourth down catch that he made something out of absolutely nothing that was probably the biggest play of the game.
Fourth down and one. Chris looks off left side, bubble screen for Kenny. It's caught, breaks a tackle, breaks another, races up the sideline, a huge first down at the 20-yard line.
I think, that'll be one of the greatest Islander performances in school history, no doubt.
Big fourth down gamble pays off. Kress looking for the corner of the end zone. Coming back is Nordhaus. He got it! Touchdown, Islanders!
And so it was a big deal to me. It was a big deal to our seniors, and I think that's when we really started to believe, hey, we're something.
We felt that like nothing could stop us after that.
Proud moment. You guys rose to the occasion. I'm very proud of all of you. Hey, pretty good game. It's pretty good. Pretty good game by Vegas. Very happy birthday to Tyler. We out. job. Take it in. Easy, boys.
Roll out.
All right, on your feet, Islander fans. Here they come. Your Grand Island Islanders!
It's team effort that wins. Our 11's got to play like 12. With one heartbeat. Just one heartbeat. We're all on the same beat. We're all on the same beat, like I told the DBs. Then the noise disappears. It's quiet. The game kind of slows down. But we're still playing really, really fast.
Now the Islanders have set their sights on securing one of the three district playoff spots. Their next roadblock is Millard South. David Garcia hits the hole so quickly, 5'10", 180-pound senior, 425 yards in four games, so he's averaging over 106 yards a game. And he on the receiving end gets away from one tackler, steps around another, has running room up the sideline. Back on offense, Garcia tries the middle, pounds his way up the middle, and he's in there. Touchdown! Brandon down about, but not until he gets it inside the 10, down to the 6-yard line. Griffin wins. Got a little help from Brady Anderson that time. They will give him a gain of a yard, but that's all there was, and the Islanders had that cover. Garcia slots to the right side. Dunning will go behind him as a blocker. Got to the corners, got some running room. Great blocking downfield by Sextro, and Dunning's going to get it down to the 3-yard line. It's go mode for Millard South. Islanders showing the blitz. Jackson Fuente came hard, made him flinch a little. Underneath pass is complete. But what a raid by Tyler Sextro to make the tackle shy of the first down marker. Pass was complete out of the backfield to Ryan Lawrence, but not enough for the first down, and the Islanders will take over on downs. Kress wants to throw, feels some pressure, gets rid of it. Got a man behind, that's Nordhue, and he is gonna go! 86 yards! Touchdown, Grand Island! 11 first downs for the Islanders tonight. They have been so solid offensively. Screen pass, and it's set up beautifully. This is Garcia. 20, 10, 5! Touchdown, Grand Island! That is textbook!
Beautiful screen pass. Millard South was coming hard after the quarterback. The last couple of series, Les has had to deliver passes under pressure. Well, they let him come this time with a screen. Extremely well blocked. Garcia takes the ball up the middle of the field, cuts to his left, and gets the touchdown.
Second down and 11. Fake it to Lawrence. Play action. Real has time. Throws over the middle. It's intercepted. Colton Kaser got the pick, and he's going to get it back to the 40-yard line. Griffin Wentz got there just as Andy Real wanted to throw, and Colton Kaser gets the takeaway. The Islanders get the ball back at their own 40-yard line, leading 34-0. 9:05 left to play in the third. Kress trying to lay one out over the top. He's got a man in the area. And look at Sextro go up and get the catch at the 30-yard line.
Post-route by Sextro. Excellent coverage by Millard South, free safety. But sometimes you just have to want the ball more than the other guy, and Sextro went up and got it.
This is only the second time the Islanders have tried to go for it on third down. Garcia does right up the gut, and he's gonna go! David Garcia, touchdown, Grand Island!
Dive action by Garcia off right guard. He's following center Griffin Wentz, right guard Jackson Fuente, who blew open a hole. Once Garcia got the ball, he got up to the second level, which is the linebackers, and passed them, broke one tackle into the secondary, and the safety couldn't get over in time.
The decades of Islander football tradition has included epic battles against teams from Lincoln, from regular season rivalries to postseason showdowns. Tonight, a new chapter begins
as Grant Allen faces Lincoln Pius X for the first time ever on the gridiron. Welcome back to Aldrich Field and Lincoln as we get ready for the first ever matchup between the Thunderbolts of Lincoln Pius X and the Islanders of Grand Island. Islanders have won four of their last five. The only setback so far, opening week, losing to Kearney 26-14. And of course, 2 weeks ago, losing at Omaha North 56-21. Press looks off right side this time. Little pass and go. This has got a chance. Kenny got behind the defense at the 45. A foot race. Kenny is not going to be caught. A little razzle dazzle. They brought in Cole Evans as a wing back that time. And Evans is able to hook up with Kenny, and they go the distance. Oh, my goodness. That is 83 yards. Try to run a little curl trap. Jablonski's going to be spun down. Layaway, though, came in and ripped away any semblance of blocking at all. Third down and five. Jablonski will run that sprint option towards the right side. Got the pitch away, but terrific run support by Will Nordhue. Now Garcia breaking it off left side. He's got some running room at the 50, the 40, the 30. He's going to get escorted all the way home. 73 yards, touchdown Islanders. A 73-yard run for David Garcia, and the Islanders jump back out in front. It took two plays again. This time they go 80 yards for the score. Islanders back to a four-man front. Jablonski hides it well, trying to go on. That's Hansen behind the defense and broken up at the last instant. What a nice recovery down deep by Tyler Sextro. 6 coming up here. Jablonski read options. Going to be spun down. Look at the job by Jackson Puente. Jablonski slant pass, tipped away and almost intercepted. Colton Kieser read that. What a great play over the middle, and the Islanders take over on downs at the 36-yard line. First down and 20 for the Islanders. Press wants to throw. He's got a man behind the defense. That's Nordhues on the money. It's a foot race. 20, 10, 5. Touchdown. The Islanders do it again.
Wow.
64 yards. There's a little spot pass again, and another first down for the Islanders. Kenny breaks away from tackles. Got one man to beat. That's Werdekamper at the 10. Kenny goes for the end zone, and he's in there. Touchdown, Grand Island. 65 yards. They go 80 yards in five plays, and the Islanders extend their lead. 10-19 left to play in the third quarter. It's Grand Island 28, Lincoln Pius the 10th, 7. Camper taken down in the backfield. A great open field tackle that time. Reed Bender came ripping up from his linebacker spot and took his legs right up from underneath him. Press wants to throw, looking in the corner. He's got a man. Oh, that's Nordhues! Touchdown, Islanders! The Islanders extend their lead with 5:02 left to go in the third quarter. 50 plays. 80 yards. That's the sustained drive they were looking for. Third down and 8 coming up here. Robertson wants to throw, looks over the middle. It's intercepted. That's Jackson Pulley with the pick. He'll get it back across the 28. The Islanders take it right back. Jackson Pulley gets the takeaway for Grand Island. The Islanders showing blitz. Low snap. Jablonski trying to recover, and he's going to be dropped back at the 32-yard line. Pius trying to pick up the tempo. Jablonski trying to head to the outside, and he's going to be taken down. Reed Bender with the submarine tackle. Angles it for the corner. The Islanders with good coverage, and they'll down it again inside the 5-yard line. And Dylan Thompson, again with the deep coverage, was able to make the play. Pair of touchdowns to open a 21-7 halftime lead, and they go on to the win here tonight on the road in impressive fashion, downing Lincoln Pius the 10th by a final score of 35-20. The Islanders now really exhibiting their big strike capability, and with a game at Bellevue East next week and then a regular season finale at home against Lincoln Southeast, you're going to need all of your weapons. It's a tough battle for a playoff spot in District 4.
We got to get some things fixed before another Road Warrior test, right? Now we just keep it rolling. Now we keep it rolling. Doesn't matter where we take our traveling circus. We'll fight anybody anywhere. Bellevue East is next. Bring it in. Good job. Good job.
We were rolling. We were ready to roll that week. I think coming off the Pius game, we were upset with how we finished, and we wanted to come out and play a full game, or as much as we were going to be allowed to play.
That was kind of a business trip, you know, attitude for that one. You know, we knew that they were having a down year, but it was also their senior night. They had some playmakers. You can't overlook anybody, and our kids did a really good job of not overlooking them.
Yeah, that was an awesome game. We came out fast, and we were just ready to go.
Well, probably the longest day that we had all season. No school that day, which makes it tough. Kids come in early, go through our weight routine. We let them go, manage your day, you know, come back for a walkthrough, get on the bus. You know, decent length trip. You know, we're used to traveling, but decent length trip. And, you know, just an extremely long day. And for our kids, kept their focus really well. Came out and started fast and really dominated, you know, from the start. Bellevue East had some very good athletes, and they were very difficult to defend. They ran some things that were pretty challenging, and I thought overall defensively we played well. Offensively, we did some really, really outstanding things and played really fast. That was exciting to watch.
Well, we're at Bellevue East High School, where tonight the Islanders take on the Chieftains in a District 4 battle. Kress gets a look up right side, pass complete. That's going to turn into a score. Peyton Kenny on a little comeback route at the 10, spun away from the would-be tackler and takes it in. Touchdown, Islanders. Walt wants to throw, rolling left, laying it out over the top. Peyton Kenny with the opportunity and gets the interception back at the 48-yard line. Running room up the right side. Could it be two early scores for Kenny? Leaps over a tackler at the goal line and gets it back for the touchdown. Just like that, the Islanders add to their lead. It took 26 seconds for the Islanders to get their second touchdown. Peyton Kenny gets his sixth pick of the year, his first pick six, and the Islanders extend their lead to 14-0. Walls rolling right, feels pressure, now tries to cut back against the grain, escapes one tackler, but Keezer will not let him get away, gets the drop, the sack back at the 25-yard line. Back to the pistol set for the Chieftains. Walls spun down in the backfield, that ball came out. Jackson Pawani picks it up, starts rumbling towards the end zone. They're going to tackle him at the 1-yard line, but the Islanders come up with a big defensive play again. Give it up to Garcia, try the right side, and he'll walk in untouched. Touchdown, Islanders! Griffin Wenz was able to team up with Reed Bednar for a little 1-2, meet you at the quarterback meeting. Kress looks off left side, he's got a man all alone. That's Nordhues inside the 35. He'll push it ahead down to the 28-yard line. Give it off to Garcia, lowers the shoulders. He's headed home. Touchdown, Islanders! That ball was tipped. Laylaway, though, came ripping up that time with pressure, and that is a fingertip away from being intercepted. Kress gives it off up the middle. Garcia running an inside zone play. Breaks a couple of tackles, spun down, but not until he gets to Bellevue East territory. Kress wants to throw. Has a man down the left side. That's Kenny behind traffic. Picked it away from the defender. Looks for the corner. He's going to get it. Did he get in there? Yes. Touchdown, Islanders. Peyton Kenny does it again.
Wow.
Pressure. They throw it underneath. Ball is deflected and almost intercepted again. A deflected ball that the Islanders had right in their hands, and that time it was Kyle Perkins that couldn't quite hang on. Grant Allen goes back to the ground game, and that's John Kirkland that blasts his way up the right side for 8 yards. But Garcia keeps the pile moving, gets a couple of bigs rolling with him. They move the pile ahead to the 40-yard line. However, they rule the ball came out. The Islanders have turned it over. Garcia slow getting up. We've got a fumble on the play. It'll be Bellevue East's football. At the 40-yard line, the Islanders suffer their first turnover of the night.
Garcia holding his left knee. There's also a Bellevue East defender on the field about 7 yards downfield from Garcia. There was the scrum. And I don't know if that was the result of the ball being taken out or if there was just a meeting and the ball got stripped out of the pile. We have two players down one from each club about 7 yards apart on the field in front of the Islander sideline.
Garcia getting attention from Todd Goshorn and the staff over about the 38.
First thing on the headset is, you know, how's David? You know, how's David? And
usually I know when I'm out there, and Todd didn't really know for sure. I think, or, you know, Todd's pretty wise that way. He doesn't tip his hand right away, but I knew it was going to be something where he probably wasn't going to play the next week.
I talked to Todd right away afterwards, and I just said, give me a percentage. I mean, what are we looking at? He goes, it's about 50-50. And then I went in with Todd in the training room that next day on Saturday, and you could tell that his football days were done. It just, when you picked up that leg, it was apparent.
I mean, if I would have holding on to that ball, it would have been a different story. I would have just fell on the ground or kept running.
It was a gut punch, I'll be honest with you. It took our kids a couple days just to digest it. I think as coaches, maybe you're a little bit quicker because you have to start preparing for that next team right away regardless. We feel terrible for David. We know it's going to impact our team, but we've got to prepare for Southeast, and there's four game tapes to break down, and there's preparations to make, and so we had the luxury of not being able to think about it a whole lot, where our kids thought about it a bunch. And so, yeah, we had to make some adjustments, but by Tuesday, kids were ready to roll. Kids were ready to take that next man up mentality and play for David.
Definitely was not a good factor for our team because he's an amazing player and good guy, and it sucks that he was done after that game. It really did.
He was a playmaker. He had a lot of good plays, and there are some scenarios where if we had him, the tides really would have shifted. But yeah, we got to adapt and overcome.
Just something you have to learn through and just get through and just forget about it. I mean, it'll probably make you better.
We wanted to play for him, so we just kept playing. Every day we come to practice with our hard hats on, ready to work, and we knew it was all for him.
Like, in practice, I mean, not everything clicked quite as well. I mean, we didn't have, like, that big, physical, fast, just kind of freakish guy out there with us.
So you try to make up for it not only just by putting in the next guy, but also by using a little different strategy on some things, and that's just something every football team has to deal with. So
we have kind of this process goals, and one of it is, it's not about me, and I kind of take that to heart because I have that brotherhood around me. They help me out, and I don't know, it's just
grace, dignity, positive attitude, continue to be out there coaching his teammates, given his insights. I don't think you could handle it any better than what David did, to be honest with you, and always admired David for that. It wasn't a, oh, woe is me, all the attention comes to me. That's not the kind of kid David is. That's not his character. But he was more, how can I still serve? How can I find a way to serve this team? And that's a testimony to David.
Every play, I guess, is a gift. If you look at David, you look at just football in general, every play is something new. And the next play, when it's over, it's gone. So you just got to move on to the next play. There's no time to sit there and, I guess, be frustrated about how you've performed previously. You just got to step up, play the next play.
Every single year, I speak directly to a couple things, and one is your careers are very short. Embrace it, enjoy every moment, squeeze every bit of it as you can out of the moment, so that when it does end, you can hold your head high and say, you know what, I did everything, and I did everything right.
All right, be there for your brother, let's go! Brother, on three, one, two, three.
Southeast was a tough game. It was exactly that, a 15-round fight. And they wouldn't give up, and we weren't going to give up.
No, they kept fighting. It was punch, counter punch, and we never did flinch, which is a really admirable quality to this bunch. And then some of our issues were self-inflicted. You know, you turn the ball over enough, it's going to be tough to beat a good team.
That's football. That's not an excuse. Sometimes you have plays go against you, and you've got to overcome it. And we just didn't do enough to put ourselves in a position to withstand those types of plays.
But to still be in the game and still be fighting and overcome some of the, you know, the unlucky bounces of the game, and to be in a position and actually take the lead with 7.5 minutes left, and to be right in there with a chance to win it, I thought was remarkable.
I was proud of them because it got more physical as the game went on, and the more physical it got, the more physical they got, and it was, I'm not backing down. You might have, I might give me a standing eight count, but I'm coming off the ropes and you better be ready. I thought that was really something for those kids.
And when you lose a game like that, I think it's a little harder to recover. Now when we found out it was Kearney, and you know, it was, you know, a team that obviously it's a big game, we play them. I don't think, you know, the kids from that standpoint had any problem getting excited to play.
When I saw the bracket, I saw Kearney, I saw Omaha North, and I saw Lincoln Southeast all on the same side. I was just thinking we could all get those games back.
We just couldn't get it going. We couldn't. I mean, the tempo we run at, we have to get a couple nice plays stringed together, and they did a great job of just shutting it down.
I think all of our kids would be the first to say, hey, I should have made a play here, could have made a play there that would have extended a drive, which would have given us a chance.
It's just one of those games where they were playing at a high level. You know, they were playing at a high level, and you know, it was just, they were just better than us on that night.
You know, it won our night.
Fought hard, did everything I asked you to do. Seniors, I'm proud of you. Okay, thank you for everything that you've done for our program. Been a tremendous bunch, okay? This should be a great motivation for guys coming back, because we got so much work to do. We got light years to go, light years, okay? Been a great year though. Feel good about our year, feel great about our effort. Wouldn't trade you for no one. Okay, touch a team.
Didn't drive to Kearney thinking our season's going to be over tonight. We're driving to Kearney thinking, okay, this is our game, and we're going to be playing again next Friday.
It's an abrupt end, and it's a very cold end at times. You know, only one team in each classification is going to end on that highest of notes.
There'll be a void, and voids are always filled with something, and it can be filled with something positive and good, or it can be filled with something negative and bad, and so we spend time, and I have just this week, on talking about, hey, you know, what's next? Whatever is next needs to be not about you, but serving others. Whatever is next needs to be about excellence, pursuing excellence. Whatever's next needs to be about outworking everybody around you, and whatever's next needs to be about you being a man of character.
First of all, thank you guys for your incredible commitment. I meant exactly what I said. I say what I mean, and I mean what I say, which isn't always great sometimes. But in 30 years of doing this, I started doing this in 86. I can't think of a team that's gotten more out of itself than you guys. I really can't. The 06 crew, probably pretty close. You know, I would put you guys in the same category. But in all those years, I've never seen a team, you know, max out its God-given potential as much, and that you're to be commended for that. You guys are uncommon, and we thank you for that. I thank you for that from the bottom of my heart. It's been an honor and a privilege in every way, shape, and form. I cannot stress that to you enough, how big a blessing it's been to coach you guys. You guys have been phenomenal in every way. So,
looking back on the 4 years I've had and thinking I wouldn't want anything else, it was the best time of my life. I'll remember it forever. I made some awesome friends. I've made some awesome memories.
Being able to say that I played for Coach Tomlin, because he's an outstanding coach, and being a brotherhood like Islander football has is probably the best feeling ever to know that you have someone there for you 24/7 whenever you need it.
I'd say it made me a better man for sure. I mean, I'll use all these lessons that I've learned from Coach Deion Swanson all the way throughout my whole entire life.
It's more than football, it's more than just the game. It's like that strong family bond. It's that, like, you're gonna grow up and you're gonna support your family, and they let you know that it's more than football.
I don't know how to explain it. I've never been part of something like this, because it's like my first like big thing, and it's amazing, I guess.
To me, we came in and we were kind of like boys, and Coach Swanson and Coach Tomlin kind of built us up and made us into who we are, the men we are.
Because it's the brotherhood, it's the pack, it's the family. It's just setting you up for more success in life than anything ever will, I think.
I wouldn't be or heading in the direction I would be today without all the discipline and hard work and training that we've had throughout the 4 years. So I'm really thankful for that.
Coach Swanson, Coach Tomlin, everyone will push you farther than you've ever dreamed of. You're willing to put in the work, you'll become such a better person, better player, and everything.
Back when I was in middle school, they would talk about how when we were conditioning, one day you're gonna be up there in Gish, and then I would go to their games sometimes, and I saw how hard they played, and then how everyone would be there, and how emotional it was, and I knew I wanted to be a part of it since I was back in sixth grade doing Little League, and I just wanted to be one of those people that someone would look up to when I was in high school.
Well, this program, I can say for sure, it teaches you a lot about life and the work ethic, which is kind of forgotten nowadays. But you learn to embrace it, and you see the good side and everything, and you attack everything, you know, with a strong force, and you'll face every problem head on.
I'm glad I went through this program because it's taught me a lot, like life lessons and stuff. So what I would say to them is just, there's no other place where you're gonna find it.
It's tough because we do expect a lot out of them. And, you know, we'd be lying if we said that doesn't run some kids off, some kids we'd like to have around. But for us to be competitive at that level, we have to have that level of expectation. And I say the same thing about my own kids. You know, if you have low expectations for them, what's that say about what you think about them as a person? I don't expect much out of you. I don't think that's sending a good message. You're displaying confidence in them. I expect a lot out of you. You come into this program and you're part of something big. And you can go be a big fish in a small pond, or you can go be part of something bigger than you and let it raise your level. And I think anytime you surround yourself with great people, you're gonna be pleased with the results.
I have enjoyed this season and having the honor of working with all of you probably more than I have for most of my career. It has truly been an honor and a pleasure to work with them. And I would hope, and I guess if I had a wish for them, is that they truly internalize everything that they've learned and in all the ways that they've grown and move forward and to continue to grow, continue to use those as tools to make the world around them better. Because I think they have the capacity to truly be difference makers and have a real impact on the world around them, where they go.
Well, you know, if I go all the way back, you know, I had all these guys, or a lot of them, as little biddies in youth camp. You know, these guys, I can go way back with a lot of these seniors, and so the relationship was there. A lot of them were on our sidelines as little kids, ball boy type of kids, and then to see them come up through the program, and honestly, not a super strong class, great class of kids. Absolutely, bar none, you know, super kids. But as football players, they came a long way because they were okay as freshmen and sophomores, but definitely not world beaters. And you know, I think they decided to I think they were all in before that, but I think they decided to take it one notch further right at the end of their sophomore year and try to carry it and see how far they could go with it. And so they came as far as any group I've ever coached. I can honestly say that. I've had no other team, with the exception of maybe one, our 06 team, that has come as far as this team. And I'm very proud of them. And that's been a very gratifying journey to go along with them.
I think that what we accomplished together was about the greatest thing ever, because we were expected to win four games this year, and I think we came together as brothers and we decided to show everybody what we were made of.
If I do it over again, I would not choose anyone else. They are by far the best friends, the best people I could ask for, and they made my senior experience the best they could be, and they're great people.
Thank you for everything. You stuck with all the downfalls that we had last year. Nick held that senior class up, and we came and responded with this year with Sam Folds. We just stayed together as a whole, and hopefully that lives on throughout the rest of our lives.
Thank you, really. I mean, everything you guys have done for me, and I mean, I hope I was able to change some of you guys' life the way you impacted mine, and it's like family now. I mean, just can't separate the bond we got.
CP on three, one, two, three, CP!